Hey there, I'm Dawson, and today I'm going to teach you how you can execute any node multiple times in a single process flow by using multiple node instances, or M&I for short. Now, M&I can do a lot of powerful things. For example, you could use M&I in a user input task to assign that task to a list of individuals rather than to just a group or single user. A really common use case for M&I is to use it to spawn multiple instances of a child process. That's actually what we're going to be going through today in this tutorial. Now, to configure M&I, and this is true in every single node, go ahead and open up the configurations for that node and go to the other tab. You'll see here at the top, there's a checkbox to very easily turn on M&I. And then from there, you get to decide how many instances of that node you want to spawn, as well as what those instances do when they complete. So today, we're going to get to see an example of M&I where we're going to be using it to create users in bulk. Really, really cool and useful way of using M&I. Like I mentioned, we're going to get to see it used from a parent to a child process where we're spawning several activities within a child more than one time. So, we're going to do this in a few different ways. I'm going to follow this list over here, show you what we're going to do. This will also be in the description down below if you'd like to follow along there. We're going to start by creating an editable grid. And I do want to say, I'm going to be going through this part of the tutorial pretty quickly. If editable grids are newer for you, or if you need some help understanding a little bit deeper what I'm describing when I go through that, make sure to go back and watch the basics editable grid video in this YouTube channel. It's going to walk through a really similar interface as to the one that I am going to build. So strongly recommend going and watching that if you have not. But what I'm going to do is use an editable grid within a form layout. I'm going to create a rule input that's type map and make sure that it is an array. And in that rule input, I'm going to capture a bunch of different new users. For each user, I'm going to capture first name, last name, username, and email. Once that editable grid is completed, I'm going to go ahead and create a parent process. That process is going to receive the editable grid and then pass each user into a child process one at a time through the use of M&I. That child process is going to create each user, and then it is also going to send an email to that user notifying them that a new account has been created. So that's everything that we're going to run through. There is a note in here that says, be a little bit careful with M&I. It's not a use it whenever you can type of solution. It's a functionality that you want to only use when you know that your list of data points is relatively small. Now, this example today is a pretty good one. Since we're manually typing in our new users, we know that that list is not going to ever grow too large. But if your list is ever going to exceed 1,000 per se, you may want to consider a different solution rather than using M&I. Let's go ahead and hop into that editable grid together right now. You'll notice I've already made the interface. So if you haven't yet, go ahead and create one and go ahead and drop in a form layout. I didn't include a cancel button. Doesn't really matter for this example. I just have a label at the top and a submit button in there. I've also already created a rule input. So go ahead and add in a rule input if you need to. It is going to be of type map, and it also needs to be an array because we need to be able to capture several different things, but for more than one new user. Now, I do want to point out here that M&I isn't just for maps. Yes, we can pass a list of maps into an M&I node. We could also pass in any other type of array, whether it's a list of dictionaries or even a list of records. So once you have your rule input in place, you can go ahead and hop into the expression and just add everything that I'm about to add. And as I mentioned, I'm going to go through this very quickly because we do have a video that dives into much more depth on each of these different elements. So first thing we know every editable grid needs is columns. So I'm going to go ahead and add in my grid. And then I'm going to add in the header cells. Now I have included 5 here. There's 4 fields that we must capture for a new user. First name, last name, username, and email. And then I have a blank one that is going to be treated as my delete column. And that's simply going to allow me to remove any rows I may have unintentionally added. Now, because I do not need all of those columns to be the same width, I'm also going to go ahead and add in my column configs, which is going to allow me to make that delete column a little bit thinner. Now let's go ahead and add in the rows. This is what's going to allow me to actually capture the new user information. So you'll notice here in my rows, I am looping through my rule inputs. And for each row, I'm going to be capturing a text field for first name, a text field for last name, a text field for username, and then lastly, a text field for email. And then I do also have the configuration here for my deletion of each row. So that's going to be a dynamic link that's saving over my rule input and removing whichever row I want to delete. Another thing to note, I am using a map type, which means I'm defining the actual field names right here in this form. So whatever you've named each of these fields, including capitalization, you must carefully name them the same exact thing when you reference them in your process models. And then finally, let's wrap up this form by adding in our row link, which is allowing us to actually add a new row and populate it with new user information. So there we go. We now have our fully functioning editable grid. We're able to add as many new users as we want, and then also capture those four pieces of information for each user. Let's go ahead now and move on to the process models. These are the things that are actually going to take all this stuff and use it, and we actually get to play around with some M&I functionality. Okay, I have already created two processes. I have one called create user, which is going to be my child process. And then I have one called create new users, which is going to be my parent process. The parent process is going to receive the full list of users and pass them one at a time into my child using a subprocess. So we're actually going to start with the child process here. The child process will not have a start form. It instead will receive information from the parent. So you must create your variable manually. Go into properties, go to variables, and go ahead and add in a new process variable. It has to be the same type as whatever we had before, which is map, of course. And yes, it is a parameter because it needs to receive information from the parent, but it does not need to be multiple. Because again, this child process is going to be creating one user at a time for us from a list provided by the parent. Okay, we've got our process variable in there, and now I'm going to go ahead and add in the create user smart service. Now, if you haven't used this smart service before, really simple to set up. Pop it open, go into the data tab, and it only needs four things. It needs a username, a first name, a last name, and an email. Well, guess what? Those are the exact same four things we're capturing on our start form. Fancy that. To show you what's configured in each of these, I passed in my process variable value, and I indexed it to the field that matched whatever value it's expecting to receive. So I'm passing the username into the username, and et cetera, et cetera. Right. Be careful, like I mentioned before, you have to make sure that the casing and the spelling is exactly the same, because this is a map type. When I push dot after my process variable, it does not automatically recommend the field name to me. So you have to make sure it is typed in exactly as you want. Okay. Next, I'm going to go ahead and add in my send email node. These are the two activities that we are going to be generating for each new user. We're going to create them, and we're going to send a confirmation email. So go ahead, pop that email open, go to setup. We're going to do this very simply. Just send it from the process model. No need to get too fancy. In the to field, I have this sending it to the new user's email, and I used the to email address function. Now keep in mind, we didn't place any sort of validation on that email field in our form. So there's no guarantee that this will work. And in fact, if the email is fake or wrong or broken for some reason, this node will result in an error. So it might be easiest to, instead of putting this, actually just go ahead and put in your personal email in this box. That's always a safe bet for testing things. Put in any subject you want, doesn't matter, and throw in some sort of message body. I always like to put in the personal touch there of adding in that new user's first name. Totally up to you what you want to put. Okay, we now have the completed child process. It is going to receive a single set of user information, create that user, send an email to that user. Next, let's go ahead and set up the parent. And the parent is where we actually get to use M&I. So now we're getting into the good stuff. So this process is going to be receiving a list of users from our start form. So go ahead into the properties to start form and search for that form that we created together. Do we want to automatically create process variables from the rule inputs? Absolutely yes. This is going to then show up in my variables tab as a map type, parameter, and as multiple, which is what we expect for the parent process. The parent's the one receiving everything. Once that's in place, all we have to do is go ahead and drop in our sub process to then point to our child and pass all of those new users into that child process. Now keep in mind, the child is only creating one user at a time, so we're not going to pass in all the users at once. Instead, open up the sub process node, go to other, and we're actually going to MNI over that child process. We're going to run it for as many different new users as we add. So make sure to select run one instance for each item in and choose your new user's process variable. That is going to run this for as many users as you add on the form. So if you typed in four new users, it'll run the child process four separate times. It doesn't matter what we select at the bottom because there's no nodes following this subprocess node in our parent. It doesn't matter what we do with each of those instances once they complete. So we can leave this set here, go back to the setup. I'm going to use the directory now to point to my child process. And finally, make sure to pass in the information from my parent to my child. One thing to point out here, the child process has a map type that is not an array. But the parent process, new users process variable, is an array. So how do these match up? Well, because we're using M&I, this is now smart enough to know that it's looping through my process variable list and passing in each new user one at a time to the child process. Pretty cool. So this is now fully configured. You can set all of this up and you can begin to test this and see how it works. What you should see in your process instance, once it's run, is a completed parent process that looks like this. And then you can check on the process details. In the subprocesses, you'll notice that for each new user you added on the start form, you should have a unique subprocess instance for that user. So I created three fake users as I was testing this. So you should be seeing something really similar. So awesome. We're able to get through all this with the editable grid, with the child process, and actually get to use M&I over multiple activities within that child process. Pretty cool. Hope you guys enjoyed this. Make sure to subscribe to this community YouTube channel so you can see a bunch of other videos just like this one. Take care.